is about 84 lakh joon. You've obviously seen every, and you've been in every single other talk now, so you've got the insight to everything. In some ways, you're unlucky, really, because this talk or discussion is like the glue of everything else, because this is what's going to explain the system that we're in. Whereas everything else was how to get out, practicalities, ways, why do we need a guru, all those kind of things. So you're lucky in the sense that it comes at the end, because it kind of glues it all together. Why we're doing all of those and why we get all that information. Or you can look at it the other way, that this could have come first and then you get the information afterwards. So one way or the other, you've got good or bad in the sense that you're getting it at the start or you're getting it at the end. So I've started off with this Pankti Sri Guru Amar Das Sahib, because the meaning of life really is to realize that we're the embodiment of Waheguru. So Waheguru's light, divine light, jyot, energy, God particle, whatever you want to call it, exists within us. How it exists, I can't share with you, I can't tell you, because I don't know how it exists, but it exists in each and every one of us. And the meaning is to realize that. Realize the system, and how do we come out of the system. Okay, so that's what we're here to do. And then, these kind of questions in this talk, these are the kind of questions you may have about the system. So I'm going to try to go through these questions. Now the key ones are in the middle there, number 6 and 7. How does the system of reincarnation work, and how do karma affect us? And further from that, what's hukam all about? Is everything pre-written? Do we have free will? So we're going to discuss all of those. And I'm using that word discuss because me, very much as a person, if I'm learning something, if I'm seeing something, and I see something, I want to ask a question on the spot. I'd always, you know, when I was learning at school, that's what I would be like. Otherwise, I won't be able to learn. So I don't mind if anybody at any point stops in between and says, what's this? Now, some of you might not like that because our mindset might be you like to do everything at the end. But I don't mind whichever way you want to ask a question, whether you want to ask in the middle, whether you want to ask at the end. At the end of each slide, if I remember, I'll try and sort of give everybody opportunity, anything, want to make any clearance on this point. We'll spend a bit of time on it and then we'll try and move on. So just to try and clear any confusion, because as you go through, there's a lot of concepts I'm going to share of the system, how everything works. And it can be a lot of information, can be too much information. But these, like I said, are the sorts of questions everybody asks, and it sort of interlinks and just breaks everything up. The ones at the end there, in terms of who are we, what is the makeup of our bodies, what are the steps to realize the truth, how can we become one with Waheguru, we may or may not get to that in this time. Because actually, what I've noticed in the previous discussions, we're spending a lot of time on 6, 7 and previous, just for our understanding, which doesn't matter, we don't get through all of it, because we're going to get time later on this afternoon to go through some of that if needs be, or I'll just quickly go through it. So it doesn't matter, because the key bit, like I said, is that middle kind of area. But there, all the questions that when I was coming into Sikhi, and even still now, I have these questions. When we've done these camps in the past, we do Q&As. These are the kinds of questions people are asking. And so we decided this time round, let's just answer the questions before they come. So when you do ask questions, they're deeper questions instead of these surface layer questions. So hopefully we'll go through those. So to understand reincarnation and karma and hukam and all that kind of stuff, we need to understand the system, how it started, where it came from, what Maya is, why did Waheguru do it. So I'm going to go through a little bit of that, like I said, just for our understanding as a background to how all of that system works. So Waheguru is in a state of sun. I'm going to try and use words that we find in Gurbani, that we find in Punjabi books, that we find as preachers speak, because as part of this is to learn those words as well. It's not just about doing everything in English, you just learn those, so it just helps you on your own development. So they use the word sun. Sun means, so this is before anything is created, Waheguru is in a state of sun. Sun means they, if we say we are in a state of sun samadhi, that means we are in a state of mind where we are fixed and fully concentrated on Waheguru. Fully focused. So that's not like just sat here, close my eyes, I'm focused, I'm thinking about God. It means completely, you know, like we're in a deep sleep. Guri neend, did that ganeya? Guri neend? We don't know about anything, do we? Somebody could be burgling around our house. Somebody, like this morning, we're just having a chat to the Singhs. A lot of us are tired. The showers are going. We can't, you know, can't even hear the showers. People have come in and out, all sorts. Guri neend. We're completely asleep. We are not experiencing anything outside. A sun state is like that, in the sense that we are completely turned off from everything else. apart from Waheguru, completely. Waheguru was in that stage. Now your question might be, if there's one God, they're all powerful, why are they fixed on themselves? This is how it's described. They are affixed on themselves. How they do that, I can't, you know, some questions we can't answer because we're not spiritually there yet to be able to answer those questions. Okay, that state is called sun. We can, or sun samadhi, we can get to that state when we're completely fixed and in tune with Waheguru. Waheguru is in that state. They have a thought, Icha. Icha rakhiyunane. Be from one form, because there's one God, ik oankar, everything is one. From one form, they want to create multiple forms. So while they're in that state, they had a thought. Now you need a mind to have a thought. We have a mind, man. We have a buddhi, intellect, to think. Now again, so you might think, where is he going off on tangent? Some people have deep questions like this, and they might question, well, if God is outside of a mind and mind is a lower level thing, why will God have a thought? This is only a way to describe it and help us understand. God doesn't have a mind. We have minds. It's part of our body. We have a buddhi and intellect. We have arms, legs. They're all made up of our body. God doesn't have that. God is nirgun, formless, no characteristics. So some of these words are only to help us understand. And even when we translate in English, they go further from the truth, or because English translations even take us, so sometimes you can't find words to even translate the Gurmukhi words, so we're making up words, as I'll use some words later on, and just to help us understand. So it's just to help our understanding. So they have an ichha from one to make multiple. Now, if they make multiple, say that's God, let's just say that's God, and they make multiple, they make another, ultimately there'd be two gods, wouldn't there? Who would be the leader? Who would be the almighty? One or the other or both? So when they set up this simple of multiplying, they don't set it up like this because there's still only one God. They set it up how they put their energy source, their particle, their jod in everything they create. That's how they are multiple. So God is within you, 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 me. That's the multiple form of God. But that jod is still the same. It's like I take this cup, go to the ocean, pull the water out, put it outside the ocean. That's water in the ocean, and that's water in the cup. They're both water. They're one and the same. Water is still only water, still one. But they're different. That's the glass of water that I'm about to drink. That's the ocean water. Different names, river. But then, when you pour this into the ground, it will find its way through streams and lakes, and it will go and become one back in the ocean. So it comes back to its original state. Do you understand that? So that's how God decided to make his multiple forms. So when he made his multiple form, that idea of making multiple is called Maya. So when we hear that word Maya in Bani, we might think of it as money, wealth. Maya means money. Bodh Maya, they call, we hear those words. It does mean that as well. Maya also means illusion. Maya means matter, like something physical, like matter, that science word, yeah? But ultimately, Maya was the thought of God from one to make multiple. That's its pure meaning of Maya. The ikton do banoneya, or ikton multiple banoneya. That's what Maya. So Maya was created first. And Maya is an illusion because Maya is not fixed. So Gurbani, when it talks about the truth, Gurbani will talk about truth as in true forever. When we say ad sach, Jugad Sach, Happy Sach, Nanako Sipi Sach. Why Guruji describes that at the start? Because everywhere in Gurbani, when they're going to talk about Sat or Sach in Gurbani, the word by on its own, Sach, Sat, that means true, doesn't it? Generally, that's how we translate that. A definition of true in Gurbani or Guru's teachings is true forever. True in the past, true in the present, true in the future. So although I'm true now, I'm sat in front of you, I'm talking, you're true. We're all true now. We're not true forever, because there was a time when we weren't true, because we weren't even born yet. And there'll be a time when we won't be true afterwards, because we'll be dead. We're true for this period, but we're not eternally true. Gurbani's word of truth is about eternally true. So anywhere you see that in Gurbani, it means eternally. So that's why Maya is an illusion, because an illusion, like a Miraj in a desert, you see it, you get there, it's gone. That's like what we are. It's like, this is like a dream. A dream is good when we're in it. If it's a good dream, we wake up, we're half asleep, we can kind of realize we're in a dream, and we know, no, I want to go back to sleep. I want to stay in this dream. This was good, I like this, I enjoy this happening, I hoped it happened in real life. But then we wake up, it's gone, vanished, we forget about it. That's what's going to happen here, we're in the dream. That's why Gurbani talks about this as a dream. Maya is a dream, Maya is an illusion. There'll be a time when we wake up, we want to carry it on, we'll be out of it, it's gone, finished. Then reality will kick in at that point. Such truth, fullness will kick in at that point, because at the moment it's temporarily true. So that's Maya. Maya on its own is Jada. So some things about Maya. What is Maya? What is the qualities of Maya? Is Jada. Jada means still, doesn't move on its own, cannot do anything on its own. For instance, on that side when I was talking yesterday, there were some boulders outside, so there's a better example, so this may or may not work. These chairs are Jada. Stood there, they won't move. We're not Jada, we're moving about, talking, yeah? They stood still, that chair is. Now that chair is doing good, because it's allowing you to sit on it. Yeah? Still Jada. But it can also do bad. I could pick it up and beat somebody to death with it. That's where the chair is doing bad. Even though I caused it, it needed my energy to cause it to do what it did. But that's why it's Jada. But it still made the fatal blow. I caused it to make the fatal blow, but the chair made the fatal blow. So you sort of see, understand? That's how Maya is like that. It's Jada. It can't do anything on its own. Maya needs some energy to cause it. That energy is the God energy. And Vaheguru put their parshama into, so that's the word that's used to describe it. Parshama.
So something which is jug, which is inanimate, yeah. It also has atoms and
energy, atoms, jyot, whatever.
So
that
you're just breaking down the Maya.
I'm just breaking it down so you understand how it is and what it works. Everything has Vaheguru's jyot in it. That form is because of the jyot. The colour is from the paint because of the jyot. Everything, all of creation. And that was the God particle of parshama. Vaheguru put its parshama, its shade within it. Within Maya to give it life. It's still jar, but it can now do because it has energy linked within it. So we're part of Maya, we're matter. That's why we move. That's why we talk. Because we've got Vaheguru's energy within us. Okay? Maya has two major strengths. One is called its Vikhepak Shakti. Shakti meaning strength. Vikhepak. Vikhep meaning to. So to understand some of these words, think about it on our own level. So I'm going to describe it in terms of a human. Think about our mind. If our mind wanders, it's like a kid, all over the place. You've got 100 million and 1 things to think about, yeah? That's what's called Vikhepak Shakti. We're not doing that. That's Maya causing us. That's Maya strength within us that is causing our mind to go like that all over the place. So that pataking of the mind is called chanchalta, chanchal manahuna. That's Maya. That's one of its major strengths. It has two major strengths. I'm not going to go too much more into it, just the two key ones. The second major strength is called Avaran Shakti. Avaran is a parda, a veil, a curtain, a sheath. Different English translations will go in different ways, but Siddhi is a pardaya. For instance, okay, you're sat in front of me, I know you're sat in front of me because I can see you. The light's on, I can see the light. If I put a parda over myself, I know you're still here. I know the light's on because I can see a kind of lightness, but I can't guarantee it because I have a parda over me. Yeah? So I could have been outside, you could blinded somebody, they could come in, they could hear us all talking, so they know there's people in the room, but they won't realize the people, they won't see them because they're blinded. That's Maya's Avaran Shakti. They blind us from realizing Vaheguru, realizing and seeing the truth. That's how Maya works. So that's Maya. So when God creates everything, first they create Maya through that thought. Okay? Any questions there?
Are you going to go into why that was created?
So Maya...
Is that to make it a test? Is it like it's not simple?
Well,
is that a bigger look and we don't know?
We don't know. We don't know why they did it. They just had a thought, they created Maya. They wanted to create multiple. That's why they did it. Their thought was from one to make multiple. And that's it.
Well, they don't think like us where we would say we couldn't do this. Or
yeah. Because you roti pakadi hai, bhukh lagi hai, shagali hai.
Yeah.
No, that's mind and buddhi, mind and intellect. Their level is something out there, no one can explain it. That's why they're infinite. Jeko katha ta antana Ant, Jabji Sahib. If anybody tries to explain it, even me try to answer all these questions, Jacob Kathai, if I try to explain, Ta Ant na, Minu Ant ni ona Vaheguru da. I won't get to an end of Vaheguru because they're limitless. And then the second Ant means Ant. Jacob Kathai, Ta Ant na, Ant. I won't get to the end of Vaheguru, but I'll get to my end before I even try and get near the end of Vaheguru. Because they are infinite. That's what Jabji said. So we can't understand it all. We can understand bits to help us realize what's going on. So Maya was created in three forms. It has three characteristics, three guns, three qualities. Satogun, Rajogun, and Tamogun. Now Satogun is probably, if we, in our worldly sense, is a better quality to have. Satogun. It's very simple. It's to know that Vaheguru is there. It's to have gyan, that knowledge, that Vaheguru is there. The meaning of life, we know that. But we're still under the influence of the panchachor. Kaam, krodh, lobh, mohankar, lust, greed, anger, ego, attachment. We're still under their influence. But we know there's God. We know we have to do something to get out. That's our mindset at that point. When we have that mindset, that worry, there's God. How are we going to get out of here? I've got to do something about it. I've got to learn about Sikhi. I've got to go to the Gurdwara. I've got to meet these people over here. I've got to meet those. And we're doing something. Seva kariye, whichever form that takes. We're doing something about it. We're then showing Satogun characteristics. When we show Rajogun characteristics, that's when we give and take through lalati. Lalati huna. What does lalati mean? It means greed, want, desire. We always have an ulterior motive. That's the Rajogun characteristic. So, I might be giving this talk because you guys don't know I'm getting paid a few hundred pounds for it. I'm not really, but that might be my life. Do you sort of see what I mean? I might be helping you out because I know you're a very rich man. And if I help you out, I know you're going to give me some money for it. I've always got an ulterior motive, you know? I might get some freebies out of you. I might do bad to you because I know that person over there wants it done and I'll get respect, I'll get honour. So I'm going to do it. Lalati yahna. So everything we do is for lalach. Whatever we're doing, whatever type of that lalach is. I want my mum to love me more because she loves my elder brother. So I'm going to try and help her a bit more because I want more love out of her. I'm doing that for lalach, aren't I, really? Let's be honest. I'm not doing it for a pure love, if you see what I mean. I'm doing it for that extra kind of, don't love my brother, love me more. That's what you call Rajogun characteristic. So you can apply that in any type of our situation. Yeah? And then the third, which is the worst one of those, is called Tamogun. Tamogun is, the word used is Dalidri. Dalidri means lazy. To be lazy in mind and to have a wandering mind. So we're more under the influence of Maya if we're using these characteristics, Tamogun. We're less so in Satogun. So Satogun's a little bit better. Yeah? So Tamogun, to describe, very easily is to describe an animal. Certain types of animals. Lazy animals. Eat, sleep, live, procreate. Eat, sleep, live, procreate. That's all certain animals do, don't they? That is the purest form of describing Tamogun. But we can fall into that mindset as well. No belief in God, not bothered about anything. Very lazy in mind. Dalidri huna, can't be bothered doing anything. Not bothered about God because there is no God. We're under the influence of society. Our mind is wandering all over the place. That's when we have Tamogun characteristics. All we're interested in is food. I want to eat good. I want to look good. Dress good. I want to sleep. Jagauna minu. You know, I've slept for 10 hours. Don't wake me up. I'm tired. Get angry with them. You know, the alarm clock. Chuck it out the window. Swear at your brother or sister. Why are you waking me up? Lazy in mind. That's Tamogun. Yeah? So they're the three characteristics Vaheguru used. So they've created Maya. Then they need to find a description of, you know, they have to... How is Maya going to work? They're going to work in these three characteristics. And that's where in this, we're part of this Maya, aren't we? So you can sort of apply it to yourself and look, when are we Satogun more? When are we Rajogun more? When are we Tamogun more? When are we all three together? When are we those two and not that one? The ideal really is, if you think of a strategy, the more we're doing a Satogun, the better we are because it's closer to Waheguru, if you see what I mean. So some strategies that people use as they are trying to develop their spirituality, they try and do the more Satogun stuff. They know they haven't defeated the panchachor, but they live simply. They eat little, sleep little, dress simply, speak little. Bhai Gurdasji talks about that kind of thing. So it's like steps to try and get closer, isn't it? They are more Satogun qualities. And the ones that are completely turned God away, they're tamogun qualities. So maya...
Can you be a mixture of
one? Yeah, so you could have more than one of the other, you could have all three. You could display one quality more than the other. You can have all three at the same time. They mix and match.
Do you have certain foods that are subtle and red?
So foods as well fall, because like we can fall, foods fall under that. So, oily foods and frying food, that's generally rajogun. That will fall under that. Simple, like dal, chawl, you know, that kind of basic food that Guruji tells us to eat actually is more satagun. Because there's the system that they're setting up for to help us is trying to develop a simpleness, aren't they? That comes into satagun. We're still under the influence of maya, but we're steps towards God, if you see what I mean. And then being carnivorous, that's tamogun. You know, for pure jeebdaswar, you know, can't live without meat, can't live without alcohol, can't live without drugs. Halke ho, you know when you say halke hoya putta, you must have heard that phrase, yeah? Everybody? That's more, halke hoya putta is like a tamogun characteristic. Okay. So, then creation. So we still haven't got to creation yet. So all this happens in an instant. Vaheguru doesn't spend 7 days, seven, any of those kind of things. That might be a way of certain religions explaining how it happens. For Sikhi, everything happened in an instant. Okay? But this is just broken down so we can understand it all. So they split across these three guns, creation. So God is about to create. So God, like, let's think on our level again. I'm pressing these buttons with my hands. I need a hand daughter. If I was to create my body for the purpose of delivering this discussion, I know I need a hand to press this. I need a mouth to be able to speak to you. I don't really need the sight. I could probably do it blindly. I need feet to get to here. So I need certain body parts. I need certain things to help me do this, don't I? God requires certain energies, certain sevama, certain people to do certain work, whichever way you think of it. So God creates Brahma, Vishnu and Shivji, deities to do some work. They are created with more satogun. They're created with more satogun because they know their link with Vaheguru. Because satogun's closer to Vaheguru. So they know their link to Vaheguru because they're created to do the work. Brahmaji is to do creation, Vishnu, nourish, Shivji, destroy, to deliver, to end, to finish life. How do we know this? When we read Japji Sahib every day, Eka Mai, Jogat Vyai, Ten Chele Parvan. Eka Mai, Eka, what does that mean? One God. Mai, what does he do? Creates Maya. Mai means Maya. It doesn't mean mother, it means Maya. So in that, those pangtiyan, God is describing what I've just described to you, just in 2-3 lines. And when we read the translation, it won't open it up to this. This is what that line, those lines actually mean. Eka mai, eka, one God. Fir ek maya, jogat vyai. So God is describing that they are married to maya. That's why Gurbani talks of us as the husband Lord and the creation as the soul bride. Because we're in that maya. So maya is like the wife of the husband Lord. Jogat Vyai, Vyai means Vyona Kita. Ten Chele Parvan, three disciples. Ten Chele Parvan. So Parvan Kite, they created three Chele, three disciples to do their work, three energies. Ek Sansari. Sansari means to create. Sansar Banona, Brahmaji. Ek Pandari. Pandar means when you have Rastpani. Rastpani is like, you know, in the storeroom over there, Sada Rastapya for the Langar. The head of the Langar is called a Pandari. They're the ones going to design what you're eating, cook, make sure it all happens, give it out to you. Pandari, to nourish Vishnu. Ek sansari, ek pandari, ek lai diban. Lai means leta karna. Leta means to deliver, to destroy. Diban. Diban means unu ek deko, ek nu adata, leta karni di. In other words, one is the destroyer. Those pankti have just described everything that I've just talked about. But obviously it doesn't open it up. This is opening it up for our understanding. Jivtis paave, tive chalave. Jivtis paave. Whatever you decide, God, tive chalave. God uses them. They are not God, they're deities, they're underneath God. So if we pray to deities as God, we're in a false economy, as they say, because they are not the supreme power. They are the workers. Yeah? Jivtis paave, tive chalave. Jiv huve for man. However, the hukam says, that's what they do. So it's all within God. creation, nourishing, destroying. It's just God uses these. So if you believe they were actual people, if you believe that these weren't actual people, I don't want to get into that argument. You can believe they were energies, you can believe they were descriptors, whatever you believe, that's how it works. And earlier, we've heard in Jabji Sahib, Gur Isar Gur Gorak Barma Gur. Guru, Vaheguru is the Guru, is the teacher, is the Guru, is God of Isar, of Gorak, of Barma. Gur Isar Gur Gorak Barma Gur. So God is the God of Brahma, Vishnu and Shivji. And if you wanted to go further, they had consorts. Gur Isar Gur Gorak Barma Gur. Parvati Mai. Parvati was the consort of Brahmaji. Maya Lakshmi was the consort of Vishnu. Saraswati was the consort of Shivaji. God is even their guru. So earlier, we've already been told that God is above these. God has created them for this world. So that's who they are. But they've got more satogun. Because they know they're doing the work. They know what they do. They know God. God's there. And they know what they have to do. But remember what satogun said. Satogun is still under the influence of Panchachor. And as we read Gurbani, we'll see different points when, and even in Sri Dasam Granth Sahibji, we'll see different points where these deities have fallen from the Panchachor, where sometimes they become, when they in the previous ages, anger, lust even, attachment, ego, greed. So they're still under the influence of the Panchachor, even though they know about the system. So they know the system, but they are under the influence. They're not completely pure. And the Tarasila Hujun, the creation of the 8.4 million birth and death life cycle, they are created, but they are created with more rajogun and tamogun. So we fall under that category and all of the rest of it. And to be fair, we are, aren't we? Because usually, actions we do are for a reason. They have some sort of desire, some sort of want, some sort of ulterior motive. Let's be honest, with ourselves, that's how we live. And then sometimes we become lazy in mind. So this kind of works, this fits. And because of that, we have forgotten our link with the Waheguru. Because we have more Rajogun and Tamogun. And we have in a way, haven't we? We always questioning, is this, what's that? How do we get out of here? What's going to happen? We don't know because we don't know the system. So, how did he set up the system? What did he need? So God needed elements. So they used five basic elements and five Sukham elements. So let's go for the basic, bigger elements first. Panch Tat, Tarti, Agni, Hava, Pani, Te Akash. That's the words that will be used for the Panch Tat. That's fire, earth in that order, fire, air, water, and ether. Ether is the name for the non-element, no element. So where those other four don't exist, you'll find Akash. So I've written space up there because if you go out of the atmosphere, you have space, we call it space, don't we? Or kids call it space. I don't know any scientists if they call it anything else these days. When I was young, dark matter, it was called space. When I was young, there's no, you can't breathe there. There's no elements there. It's called ether, dark matter.
And dark energy.
Dark energy. So there are different words of describing that. So where those four can't go, that one resides. Even our bodies are made up with that. We have that within our bodies. And I'll show you later on, if we get to the end, some of the slides about our body, but we may not. So I'll just tell you now, in our mouths and in our ears, that's where this Akash exists. It helps with transmit sounds. Because you can even transmit sounds in space, can't you? We know that, don't we? So sounds can go through Akash. It exists in our mouth when we speak for our speech, and it exists in our ears. That's where the main part of Akash exists. Okay, and then the Sukham elements, they're called the Vishe. Panj Vishe. So when you hear the word Vishe Vikar, you might have heard that before. Vishe Vikar. You may not have. Vishe Vikar are actually two separate things. Vikar are the panch chor. Vishe are these subtle elements, these sukham tat. Sabad, saparas, roop, ras, gand. And what they are, they're like our senses. Sabad, speech, saparas, touch, roop. Roop literally means form. But for a form, we have to be able to see it, don't we? Roop, ras, taste, gand. It's like a smell, an odor, but then we need, you know, smell to be able to smell the odor. Yeah? So they're like our senses. They're called the Panch Sukham Tat. So the Panch Sukham Tat, mainly the Panch Big Tat, the Panch Five Elements, and the Sukham Tat are used to make the creation. So we still haven't created anything yet. I'm just still giving you the system before everything's created. And then from the Panj Tat and the Panj Vishe, Sukham Tat, Vaheguru creates the system of the four ages, Char Jug. We've heard of these, Satyug, Treta, Dwapar and Kaljug. We've heard of that definitely. We're in Kaljug now. Yeah? So I'm going to give you a little bit of information about these. This is scholarly research. So some of this stuff is not from Sri Guru Granth Sahib Ji, the ones I'm about to show you here, but it's what scholars have researched. Okay? Because questions I usually ask when they ask me about Satyug, how long was it? How did people get to God? What were the lifespans? So some of the stuff I've put up there is from scholarly research, not necessarily from Sri Guru Granth Sahib Ji. Satyug, 1.7 million years, that's what they say. So that is the scholarly research. Okay? I don't know if that's necessarily true, but that's what some scholars say. And what they've done is they've researched it, and they've looked at points in time, and they've looked at history, and they said, 18 Satyug Choya, that was about there, and they've kind of worked out time spans. That's what they've done. Satyug, the main way of getting to God in Satyug was Dhyan Lona, concentration. So Dhyan Lona is not meditation as we do it with a Shabad, but just looking at a point and focus. Some people even do it in this day and age. When they talk about meditation, they'll take a point and focus. Jyotalaki, just like a candle, look at a fire flickering. Look at a point in the wall. Look at the floor. Look at the tip of your nose. Try to focus on, they call the third eye, Trikutite. Different forms of concentration. You may have heard of these things, you may not have done. I'm just trying to give you some understanding of what that means. That's what the main way they used to get to God. Dharam, faith and religion, had char pehar. That's what it's described as. Now this bit is from Gurbani, comes in Asariwar. Char pehar si dharam de. Truthful living, sat karna. Tapasya, tap karna. That means disciplining the mind. We're not disciplining the mind. Disciplining the mind by doing physical acts. So you know those old school yogic ways, standing in water, head on, you know, standing head, you know, different, you will have seen pictures of those kind of things. That is the kind of tapasya that they used to do. Walking through fire, you know, all those different kind of things. Sitting out in the sun for many, many hours. So basically they're controlling their mind by forcing their body to do something different. Hat karna. Yeah, so I know something's happening outside, I really want to go outside, but I'm forcing myself to stay in here physically. How I do that, I stand in water, and I use that to keep me. And it's always linked to those panchatats, fire, water, earth. There's always something linked with those, because that was their way of trying to link with God through tapasya, through the panchatats. They were going backwards through what God created. So tapakarna, jagakarna is feeding all, mass langar. Kings used to try and feed the whole world. It would take a few years to do it. Mass langars all over the place. Jaga karnam kandaya. Spelled with a Y there. You could see it spelled with a Y. Y and J intermixed, like Kal Yog, Kal Jog, Char Yag. So Y and J's. I spell it with a Y. You might hear it being pronounced with a J. Jaga karna or Yaga karna. And then Dan. That's charity. Giving. That was how Taram, faith, religion, was described by those four things. There came a point in Satyug where a king committed a kukkaram. Kukkaram means they committed a wrongful act with a bibi, forced himself. And at that point, Satyug changed into a type of kaljug. So extra to what I'm here, because we were discussing this, in Satyug, if one person committed a paap, the whole world would have to face and pay for that crime. People lived for tens of thousands of years, their lifespan was long. The average height of people was 10, 12 foot, 15 foot. That's what they say, very tall people. It's hard to believe that, isn't it? Do you believe that people could live for 10 to 20, 100 thousands of years? Can you believe that? Honestly, can you believe it? I can't believe it. But that's what Satyug was about. I'm going to come to a Sakhi, it's going to help us believe that, understand that. That's what Satyug was about. Then when that king committed the act, paap shuru ho gaya, and taram lost one of its feet, truthful living had gone because of that act. The next age came into action, treta. Treta, three means three. It describes that now we have 3 feet on these 3 legs of taram. 3 feet of taram. Truthful living is gone. We've got the other 3. Jagakarna was the way people found God. feeding all. That was the main way. If you want to find God, jaga karo, jaga karo. Yeah? And 1.2, 1.3 million years of Treta. As Treta passed over, we get Dwapar. Dwad means two. That's describing that there's 2 feet. That if I just go through it and then you ask the questions, 2 feet of Staram. Because we've now lost Tapakarna. In Dwapar, we just have Jagkarna, feeding mass langars, feeding all, and Dhanakarna, charity. Lifespans have changed from tens of thousands to people living 1,000 years in Dwapar. People's height is a little bit shorter, maybe 8 foot tall, 9 foot average height of people. And then we move into Kaljug. They say, I maybe get this wrong now, there was that big war, Mahabharata, is that what they call it? That's when Dwapar changed to Kaljug. That's the point, reference point, they say. And Kaljug is supposed to be 432,000 years. That's how long it's going to be. The only way to get to God is Naam Simran. Only one leg of Taram remain, charity. People's average height is less, probably just under 6 foot. People live up to 100 years, not more than that really. Yeah, average age. But the only way to God is that. Now, how do we know those ages? Like I said, people have looked at points in time, have talked about Mahabharata, different things, and they've tried to come up with these ages. Charity. But that's what happens in Kaljug, isn't it? Everybody does charity, really, don't they? Take Sikhi out of it, general. And that's what gives people peace of mind. I've given somewhere good. I'm happy, I've got peace of mind. I don't care about anything else. God is just about being a good person. Dan, though, gets enough. I do good work to charity. I donate a lot of money, help people out. That's enough for me. That's my faith. That's my spirituality. That's what happens in the world, doesn't it? Let's be honest. That's what happens. We do it. Everybody does it. That's what keeps us at peace. That peace is not eternal peace. It's just a peace at that time. I did it. Then I have to do more of it. So, I have a question at this point.
What's the link between the height?
I don't know what the link is, but I'll tell you why. I'm going to come to the Sakya and explain all of this. If somebody commits a paap in Satyug, I said, the whole world pays for the crime. If somebody commits a paap in Treta, the country pays the crime. If somebody commits a paap in Dwapar, the city pays the crime. If somebody commits a paap in Kaljug, only they pay the crime. So whatever we do, it's reaction is to ourselves. Whatever we did in Satyug, good or bad, the whole world gets the fall of it. Good or bad. Yeah? That's how it works. Now, what's the link with the heights? Well, it links to Asaki. A question I had at this point was, how long has Kaljug gone? Because I'm interested in Kaljug, really, because I'm in Kaljug, so I want to know about Kaljug. How many years of Kaljug have gone? Does anybody know? Has anybody got any idea? Or do you think how many years of Kaljug has gone?
Yeah, I think they said it's when Krishnaji has to war, so 5,000 years.
5,000 years. Go on.
Yeah,
5,000. Okay, so about 5,000 years, it's probably just under now 6,000 years. So you're about right. So you look at Krishnaji. Another point is Sri Guru Arjan Dev Sahib's times. Sri Guru, have you been to Harmandir Sahib, everybody? Yes. Amritsar Sarovar, you had a bath in the Sarovar?
Yes.
Yeah? Very important place to go. We heard Hukamanama yesterday evening. Ramadas Sarovar Nate, Sabutre Paap Kamate. Sri Guru Ramadas Sahib is that Sarovar is known for. Ramadas Sarovar. On the day of Vaisakhi or around Vaisakhi, many years before the Khalsa Vaisakhi happened, Sikhs still used to gather together. Sri Guru Arjan Dev Sahibji is at a place called Santoksar. So those of you that have been to Amritsar, a 10-minute walk away from Harmandir Sahib is a Gurdwara called Santoksar. That also has a Sarovar. In Amritsar, there are 5 Sarovars. Harmandir Sahib Sarovar, Ramadas Sarovar. Beside it, with a tower Gurdwara you might have seen, Baba Atal Raj Gurdwara, in front of that is a Gurdwara called Kalsar. There's a Sarovar there. If you ever hear the word Sar after a Gurdwara, it means there's a Sarovar there in India. Not here, but in India, usually there'll be a Sarovar in that Gurdwara where you hear the word Sar. Sar means Sarovar. Kalsar, 10 minutes walk in this kind of direction if you face Harmandir Sahib. Well, that's the way I'm facing it. I don't know which way you guys will be thinking of it. So 10 minutes one direction is Santoksar. Probably 5 minutes walk the other side, after Baba Atal Gurdwara, that Tower Gurdwara, that way, is two other Gurdwara, Ramsar, there's a Sarovar, and Bibek Sar, 5 Sarovars. They're all in close proximity. You could walk and do the Ishnan in all of them within an hour, if you don't get any waiting time. So, Guru Ramadas Sahib Ji, has started the Sarovar Seva, that's what's known as Ramadas Sarovar, but before that they started a Sarovar Seva at Santoksar. And then they stopped. And then they told Guru Arjan Dev Sahibji to carry on. So Guru Arjan Dev Sahibji has gone to carry the Seva on. They're at Santoksar, they start with Santoksar. And at Santoksar, when the Singhs and Singhani are doing the Seva, they're knocking out the bricks, widening it, making everything pakka, they find a cocoon. Does anybody know what a cocoon is? A cocoon. It's like a shell and somebody's in the shell. And they've knocked open the shell and a person who was in a chankra sat down in a deep meditation. In a samadhi, in a place of sun, the word we talked about earlier. And Sri Guru Arjan Dev Sahibji brought some, heated up some kyo and they did malish on the body. Massage the body to wake the person out of the meditation. The person was 12 feet tall. And the person was asked, 12 feet tall, cocoon, tell us what's happening. He was from Satyug. He was in a deep meditation from Satyug. And they asked him about Satyug. He explained he was 12 feet tall. Loads of Sikhs gathered, just to amazement. Somebody who's 12 feet, something like a 12, 15 foot tall. He described about Satyug. He asks, where am I now? Guru Arjan Dev Sahib goes, this is Kaljug. How many years of Kaljug have passed? Just over 5,000 years. So it links in with that. And Guru Arjan Dev Sahib said, just over. So that was about 300, 400, 500 years ago. Add that on to just over 5,000 years. We're probably just under maybe 6,000 years. That's where we are. So we're in this cocoon. He's now linking to that Sakhi. You all heard of Bibi Rajani? Have you heard of Bibi Rajani and her husband? She was married by her father to a pingala. He does the Ishnan in Harmandar Sahib. He sees the crows going in, coming out. Yeah? That happened on the day of Vaisakhi. And that happened on this day. Because Bibi Rajani goes to a village called Tongpind to get food to feed her husband. He sees the crows going, coming out, sparrows. He dips into her Harmandar Sahib's rover, keeps his hand out on a branch. His leprosy is cured. His wife comes back, Bibi Rajani says, you're not my husband, you killed him. They're having an argument, he's explaining it. She's a believer of Gursikhi. She goes, that's why she was kicked out of the house in the first place, because she used to sing Gurbani, saying Guruji is everything, he nourishes us. The father and the other daughters were saying, no, our fathers, everybody, they go to Guru Arjan Dev Ji because everybody's flocked at Santoksar because this happening is happening there at the same time. That guy was called Santokha from Satyug. That's why the Gurdwara is known as Santoksar. This is happening at that time. They go to this Gurdwara, they see the 12-foot guy, but they also speak to Guru Arjan Dev Ji about their own situation. Then Sri Guru Arjan Dev Sahib Ji goes to Harmandir Sahib and carries on the seva there as well. So that just links. This all happened on the day of Vaisakhi. Some questions?
Would you say there's more people like that doing, like in a cocoon around the world somewhere?
Yes, they are, and I'm going to come to that in a minute.
Yeah,
definitely.
Two questions. You know, Dwapar ended with Mahabharata. Do we know why Treta and what event ended
there? I don't know. And to be honest with you, I've never bothered research because for me, it's about here and now.
Okay.
So there is certain events. I don't know. So I'm not going to make any up to, you know.
Okay.
There is because, in these ages, a little bit more information if you want it. Ramchandra and Krishnanji, they came in different ages. So whatever happens in their lifespans, they're in those different ages. I can't remember which way around. I think Dwapar is Krishnanji, Treta is Ramchandra, you know. And so any happenings with Ramchandra, so that's Ravan, all that stuff, that would happen in
also,
Treta.
Is each yug double the length of the other?
It seems like there's a kind of maths going on, isn't there?
Not
double, but there's a kind of multiplication going on there, isn't there? And this is what I said, why I emphasized at the start. Gurbani tells us, because our main reference is Guru, really, isn't it? So anything Guru tells us, I believe it. Anything any scholars tell us, you can believe it, but it may or may, because Gurbani is bigger than that, and Gurbani says to us, God can create and destroy in an instant. So technically, it could last that long, but if God decides, they can do what they want. But it could last that long. And these are supposed to be cycles. So after Kaljug ends, you get to Satyug. And Satyug isn't perfect if we think Satyug is perfect. Because if Satyug was perfect, why did it get bad? So don't ever think of Satyug being perfect. We need to be in Satyug and Kaljug. People talk about that. Satyug isn't perfect. We want to be one with God. It's a completely separate point.
And is there any cycles within Kaljug?
There could be, there's different prophecies. I told you about that king, because Kaljug happened in Satyug. Some people have written that number of thousands of years, tens of that, it was I think 10,000 or 20, can't remember the exact time, because that Kaljug happened in Satyug early because of that king doing that wrongful act. We'll get that paid back in Kaljug, so you get some Satyug. But this is all stuff that's prophecies and written. Do we know it's true or not? We don't know. We don't know. It's just information out there. There's no end to information and knowledge and gyan and research. You know? Sorry, what were you going to ask? So I don't know. I'm sorry.
So you said like the Hindu deities came on earth in Satyug. Are we meant to believe in them then? In a certain way?
Do you believe in me? You don't, do you? That's honest, isn't it?
Yeah.
I came in Kaljug. Why don't you believe in me? So, sorry, I sometimes answer questions with simple stupid, because I teach kids and I always try to make it very easy and simple to understand. And I think, what I mean is, I'm not disrespecting you or patronizing you. What I'm trying to say is, it doesn't matter who came.
Yeah.
We believe in who we want to believe in. We don't have to believe in anybody if you don't want to. Who should we be believing in? The almighty power. If you've got a choice of complete almighty power, God, and me, I know you're not going to choose me. Then if you've got God and somebody who creates, well, why don't you have the person who creates? It's like the geese that laid the golden egg. You get excited by the golden egg, you kill the geese, you take the golden eggs, but why do you just keep the geese? They're going to give you more and more of it. It's that kind of mentality, isn't it? So if we pray to Brahma, Shivji, Vishnu, or any other prophet, they're just like those geese. No, they're just like the golden eggs, let's say. The geese is why don't you have the creator of everything else? That's what we've got the opportunity to have. So that's hopefully what you've been learning in the other discussions. So you had me a question. You said, has this been happening? Just your question and then we're going to... Okay, has this happened before? Can I put you honestly, hand on hearts, as they say. Do you believe somebody can live for that many million... Or we were like 2 million years this Satoka would have been living. Can you believe that? I can't believe it neither. I can if I believe in my guru. That if I take it a different way, worldly sense, I can't believe it. And so,
yeah.
You know when I was talking about Maya earlier? Paradabona? Make our mind wander? When I say I can't believe it, that's Maya using its energy against me to blind me in seeing what truthfulness is. So we look for scientific proof or examples to prove it to us, to sort of lift the curtain. So I am going to give you one for this. Now, you lot are elders, I know they've banned phones in the camp, some of you might still have them. I want you to Google Buddha, deep meditation, cocoon. About a month or two ago, they found a mummified person, a cocoon type, a cocoon. And it was in BBC News, so I'm just giving you a, you know, I follow the news, BBC app, most read news, it was one of those. And it was about a month, 2 months ago, if I remember correctly, and they had pictures of this cocoon. And it was mummified, and they took... Now, if you find a mummy, so that's a dead body, yeah? And you took the layers off, the mummification off, the cocoon off, what would you expect the body to look like? Decomposed, rotted, bones, yeah? This body's intact. Would you expect hair to be on a body?
No.
This body has hair. It was sat in a chonkra. This is how Buddhists sit. He had his hands. One hand was a fist, like, I can't remember which way around it was. One hand was a closed fist. And one hand was open. It's just their way of meditating. They found his body like that. He had hair. When somebody passes away, what colour does their skin go?
White.
This had dark skin. No rotting away. Dark skin, like us, basically. So there's blood in there. He's living, basically. And he's been living in a deep meditation for thousands of years. They found his body. They thought he was dead. They did an MRI scan and they realised he's alive. Then, in the same bit of the news, they talk about... somebody, another Buddha type person, they found 50, 60 years ago and they said the same thing. But what they've done, because they go there and the universities and all that kind of thing, they don't understand this deep meditation. In the same article, they talk about the person being alive and in a deep meditation, but they'll also talk about him being dead as well because they don't understand it. But the person's alive, because if he was dead, you'd have bones, you'd have rubble, you'd have decomposition. You don't have it. I'll try and find it and show people.
So that's in Boka, he was way lucky, wasn't he?
So he, what he was, his guru, he said, I want to see God on this earth.
Yeah, so what's his Buddha doing?
Sorry?
He's in a cocoon, like, he's out for a...
Okay, Buddha, different religions have different ways of finding God. Some of them still believe in the previous ages ways of getting to God. Dhyan launa, jag karna, puja karni. We still do some of that stuff now. Puja is like, when we go to Sri Guru Granth Sahib Ji, what do we do? Jyot launa ya, tufa. There's nothing wrong, that's puja, that's worship. But it's physical puja. Haar launa maharaj te, ramale dene. That's good, that helps us develop love. It's a starting point. But ultimately, it's the Naam Simran that's going to save us. That's a medium to help us going and develop a physical relationship with our Guru. So there's nothing wrong with those. But if we get stuck in that and we don't do the other thing, so these people from different faiths, because some of their theology has come from previous ages, they're going to still do that. Like yogis still do hardcore tapasya. There's people in the world. I went to Hemkund Sahib about 6, 7, 8 years ago. A few of us went to Hemkund Sahib as a group. And obviously there's a mountain and all. Who's been to Hemkund Sahib years? First time I went, I found it really difficult to get to the... I walked all the way to the top. It wasn't for me, you know. I thought, I'm never going to do this again, you know. But as I was walking up, there was like a boulder. And there was a guy sat underneath in a chonkra. And I'm thinking, we saw this guy. Some of us thought, let's play around with him. You know, we're singing, you get this ego, don't you? A card, say we can do what we want. You know, and some of us thought, what if he's got some spiritual powers and, you know, one of us die here. You know, so we just left him. We were having a joke and we just left him as he was. And he was sat underneath a boulder this high and he was like, you could see a little gap. Because we were investing, as you do, you just check out the sights as you're going along. And there's some guy sat there and he just had, you know, those, as you can imagine, a yogi type, some wrap around his body parts around here. He's sit completely naked and his hands are out like this and he's got a little bit of hair flowing back. Just the actual picture that you'd imagine is one of those. The guy was Sandra, some guy was Sandra, a rock like that. So there are people like this that believe in this stuff. So I know Buddhists, I don't want to go off topic, but Buddhists believe in a type of nirvana. That's what they call it. Gurbani talks about nirvana. It means the same thing. Ultimate bliss. But ultimate bliss is being one with God. I might feel some anand in this day and age. I might think I've got to God. But it's only anand that I feel. The true anand is only the oneness with God. Not any other type of bliss and excitement or anything like that. Even bliss we feel in the sadhusanga, we think, inna anandaya. But that's not true anand. Anand is even better than that. That's what Guruji is telling us. That's what we're striving for over and over.
If other religions follow the above ones,
yeah,
are they still going to get to where we believe, where they get to if we follow
the knowledge? Okay, hold that question. We'll ask that question when we get into the karam. Hold that question. And then we'll talk about that and we'll come back and forth. So, we've got about 25 minutes left. So if we go a little bit over, I apologize, we started a little bit late. Okay? Charasilak Jun, so that's the system, pre the system, if you see what I mean. All that is all set up before Charasilak Jun. Now Charasilak Jun. And Charasilak Jun is 8.4 million, 2.1. We read in Chopi Sahib, Andaj, Jeraj, Setaj, Kinni, Ottabo, Jakhan, Baharaj, Dini. We read that in Chopi Sahib, some of you might remember that pankti. That describes the ways you come into the Charasilak Jun. 2.1 million lives come through Setaj. The direct translation for that is sweat. That's like an amoeba, you know. You don't, like, we need mother and father. That just comes from its own body. Yep. Through it. Setaj means sweat, literally. But it's like a chemical, like a, you could say a chemical reaction even. Yeah. Then 2.1 million. That's the lowest 2.1. Then the next 2.1 million is Ottabuj. Ottabuj means Ottabuj from the ground to grow. So that's obviously trees and plants. Yeah. Then 2.1 million. The next one is Andaj. Eggs, ande. Those are not eggs in the womb, they're eggs external, like chickens and that kind of eggs, yeah, external eggs. 2.1 million come into those form. And then Jeraj is the womb. That's how we come, and there's other animals that come like that. That's called Jeraj. They're the types of way we come into this world. And they're split in 2.1 now. Some people have a question, but I think you guys are all learning and you know. So like a dog is one jun, you can have different types of dogs. But dog is one, so that's how this works. So they talk about humans. The reason I'm mentioning this, so some people might think, but humans don't, you know, science says this, but there were different types of human species before. Homo sapiens, Homo this, you know, they have all different names, don't they? That could have been one jun. Do you see what I mean? We don't know, but that's still the top human jun, as we call it. So half of those, so 4.2, that's half, 4.2 million of those are below water, 4.2 are above water. So that's sky and land. That's how they work. Because you can get plants and rocks and stuff like that.
Sorry, does it say that quite in mind?
Yeah, so this comes from Barney, doesn't it? I'm pulling these from Barney and just expanding. Yes, Bhai Sahib.
The Jurassic land, isn't that an estimate of, like, it does change, isn't it? Because obviously you get species going extinct and then...
And then they come back. My honest answer is I don't know. Gurbani just says it as it is. That is our vichar. Some people believe, you know, there's always 8.4. Some people believe, like you say, is an estimate. I believe, personally, it's like a species thing. Some species might die out, but they might come in a different form. But they might have come in from the same category. We just didn't know. So we think one type of thing's died out, but actually, that species is still alive, but it's slightly different. It's all from the same family. Like, cats could be a species. But how many different types of cats? They say tigers are cats. You sort of see what I mean? I don't really know. You won't find the answer in Gurbani. It's just people's knowledge and development. So it's just set up like that. That's what we do know. I'm just telling you what we definitely know. This is what's definite.
Yeah, that's true. But also from reading, science hasn't reached that amount because they haven't discovered the ocean underneath.
Yeah, but
So they haven't even reached that.
Science is getting closer to that amount, though.
So it's getting closer.
Yeah,
well,
so first they thought it was like 50 million or something, yeah. And then they've gone down right down to 5 million now. Five, like, yeah. Estimated.
So they actually...
5 million, came down to 5 million.
So they can,
something like that.
Yeah, they've written an article.
It's like... Going towards eight.
Okay.
Sorry, yeah, they've discovered about 5 million and they estimate another 3.
So it ended up being
but
exact.
But
it
started it like...
But
it started to
yeah. Sorry, you were...
Last I checked on Google, it was estimating around about 8 million or something like that as well.
Yeah, something like that.
So it's nearly there then, isn't it?
So nearly there. It's under the ocean deep trenches, they don't know, certain places.
And as we know, with more research, we don't know, because how will they categorise them? You never really get to the end, will you?
Yeah.
You know? And actually... It's interesting to know, because we're in the world, we want to know about things, but is it going to affect us? Not necessarily, does it?
So, you know, like people say to kids, scientists, with evolution, we believe we came from monkeys.
I don't believe we came from monkeys, because Maharaj also goes, Asan loe loe pandar, jo kish paya so ek avar. Everything was done once. They don't have to you see the system, they did it once at the start. Everything, bang, it's there.
Also, can you develop the Dasam Dwar? Like, surely only humans, even not Homo sapiens, have like a Dasam Dwar, only humans have it, right?
I don't know. Maybe that's true, I don't... So, whatever God did it once. So, I personally, I don't completely 100% agree with science anyway. I'm going to throw you some questions, not for this talk, but Benji's right, if that's true, then humans must have been here even before. So we're not Homo sapiens, we're something, you know, we're
humans. We're not Homo sapiens, like, Homo sapiens, isn't that a different species?
It might be, I don't know, that's what I'm saying, I don't know, I'm just throwing out things to you for you to vichar.
Because there was a program not long ago that said, like, Homo sapiens, there are different species to us, Homo sapiens, as monkeys are a different species. We're in the same family, so we're under the same umbrella, but we're different.
Okay, what I believe is God did everything in one go, as W. Sad tells us. One go, sorry? Yeah, everything, one go. Everything, one go. So all what I've talked about here, up to this point, it's taken us nearly an hour. God, bang, done. Even quicker than that. Instant, everything. Ikvari.
So we believe in the Big Bang, right?
Just because I use the word bang doesn't mean to say it was a Big Bang, but you know what I mean, it happened. It happened. How it happened, you won't find it in Gurbani. You will find it anywhere. And if a person is learned enough to know, they won't tell you. So, you know, we can waste a lot of our life trying to find out or not.
The science says that as well now. Rapid acceleration, rapid...
Well, it could have been a big bang, but it could have been an instant big bang. Do you sort of see what I mean? How do we know? We don't know. So anybody who tries to make it exciting or tries to tell you, it's false. But I'm telling you, Gurbani says no one knows. Nobody knows. First reference point, always... Siddhi Guru Granth Sahib Ji. If we can't find anything there, then obviously learn scholar, you know, you take it back. History second. This is, I'm telling you, my personal way. First point of reference, Siddhi Guru Granth Sahib Ji. Second point of reference, our history. Because some teachings we find from our history. Yeah? Like Panch Pyare don't come in Siddhi Guru Granth Sahib Ji, it's history. Then after that is what the Panch Pyare said. And then after that, learned Gursikhs. After that, then it's your own mind at work. Okay, and other scholars of other places. If you want what Sikhi's view is, Siddhi Guru Granth Sahib Ji says it, so you don't need to go anywhere else. They say nobody knows, so nobody knows. Simple as that. Okay, so where was that? I was just saying science, but maybe Guruji took me off that. But my mind was Shaitan and brought me back to that. Because I was just about to throw out to you, We know the heart pumps blood. Science, just over 100 years ago, used to think the liver pumped blood. So I don't believe in science anyway. Because it could be right and it could be wrong. And what they tell us now could be right, but it could be wrong. What they told us before could have been right. They've developed into something different, which is wrong. Simple as that. I don't believe in it. Because we don't know if it's right or wrong yet. Human form, obviously, we know that's the highest. So then, now everything's created. How does the system work in creation? Karam. Karam are actions. How do they work? So, quick little demonstration for you to see how they work. Karam are three types of karam. Okay? We are doing karam now, aren't we? I'm speaking, you're looking, you're concentrating, you're thinking. Some people have slept while we're here. But every instant, we're doing so many different karam. Constantly. Yeah? That's what we're doing, karam instantly. So I'm just going to use this bit of paper to say, every time we do it, it gets written down. Some people believe there's people sat on our shoulders writing these down, good and bad. Gurbani uses that as an example, but in other places they don't use them. So they could be true, they could be false. Again, that doesn't matter. All we know is they're getting written. So just imagine this is a karam I've done. Spoke, moved hand. Just imagine, every instant it's getting recorded. When they're getting recorded and when I do them, they are called Kiryaman Karam. Actions we are doing now. Basically, every instant we're doing them, they're called Kiryaman. So I'm doing these. And I've done these through the 8.4 million lives that I've travelled in. And at the end of each life, because Maharaj tells us, Kai janam pe kit patanga. And in that Shabad, it describes all the lives we have been through to get to this human form. Gur seva te bhagat kamai tab eh manas dehi pai. So we did some previous life, we did some good actions, we get given this blessed life of a human life. Dasam dwar, the only way out is through this life. Unless you get lucky and you just get blessed as an animal, as gurus did, and Mahapurushas have done. But we, if you're talking about the general person on the street, human form is the only way out.
Can animals come out bad karma?
Yeah, everybody can come out. Even trees can come out bad karma.
Do they have that?
So trees, I'll give you a quick example. Trees. Now this is, again, it's going to be a silly example, but you can kind of understand. Because a tree can do good actions by giving us shade. When the fruit drops on the floor, we eat it. That's a good action. It came from that tree and we counted positively for that tree. Negatively, I'll give you an example. Let's say, hopefully it doesn't happen to anybody. You know what manslaughter means? You didn't mean to kill somebody, but somebody's died. Yeah? What happens when somebody commits manslaughter? Prison sentence. They get punished for it, even though they didn't mean to do it. So even if you don't mean to do an action, it's being counted. So let's say a tree, like this is the silly example. Like I say, my brain is not good enough to think of really good examples, so it's very silly. A tree cutter, you're sitting under the tree for some shade. The tree cutter doesn't see you, cuts the tree falls on your head, you die. Who's at fault there? Not you. Well, you could say it was you, you shouldn't have sat there when you know the tree cutter's cutting the tree. But the tree cutter and the tree for doing the killing. Like we talked about this chair. So, they might have done it anjanal. They might not have wanted to do it, but there will be some action placed on the tree, there will be some action placed on the tree cutter. So even when we do stuff anjanal, that means without knowing, it has an effect.
That's really interesting. If you think about nowadays, I don't know if anyone experiences this, but some houses are torn under because the roots of the tree are growing. And the house.
So that could be a bad one, isn't it? Because you
yeah, the whole house.
Even sinkholes are swallowing up houses.
Killed by a tree, a revenge. Revenge of the tree. There's a film in that, I'm sure. Does somebody have a question at the back? Okay, thank you. Okay, so Kiryaman Karam, they're the ones we're doing. So I've done those, here you go. They're mine. So in my last life, I did all of those. Okay? I did all of those. And they were collected. Sanchit means to collect. So they were collected, not just in my last life, in all my lives that I've been in, they have been collected. When I've done them, they get collected. Okay? They're in my collection pot. Okay? They are called Sanchit Karam. I've took some out because I need them for later. But these in the collection pot are called Sanchit Karam. They've been collected. And then, this is the bit that English words describe as destiny. We sometimes call them preordained. We sometimes say this is hukam. We have a type of karam which are called paralabdh. That's what Gurbani called them. Paralabdh. Now, so I've done all my... I'm ready to be born as Sukhraj Singh. Whatever I was going to come with. My body has been designed. And to live in this life, I have done many actions previously, good, bad and ugly, which I have to reap the rewards for. So, God, Dharam Raja, whoever, God's sevadars, decide, could be randomly, could be designed. So I'm saying could be because, again, no one knows this answer, so don't ask this question. No one will give you this answer, and Gurbani says it's just done. In my Sanchit Karam, some of those will come out. Because I have to reap the rewards for these. I did good, bad and ugly things. And I've got to reap good, bad and ugly things for those that I sowed. They come with me in this life. That life is not big enough to bring all of those, is it? So only that much come. And then I live this life and I have to account for these. What sorts of things are these? The amount of breaths we take in this life. The amount of nourishment we're going to be given. Fame, fortune, wealth. It's all pre-written. This is from Gurbani and Panktiya. Sail patthar mein jant upaye taaka rijik aagya karta riya. Rijik food is already pre-written. So these things are pre-written. There's a Pankti about the amount of breaths that we're going to take in life. So not the age, you're going to die when you're 79, but you're going to die having a million breaths, and you know, that's preordained. Not the age, but the amount of breaths. I can't remember the Pankti. Then, what's the other one? It's gone. Sanjog vijog doi kar chalave, lekhe ave paag. Sanjog, people we have companionship with, friends, parents, wife, husband, children, other friends, relatives, sanjog, vijog, people we have vishoda with. You could describe enemies, people you don't like. It's all pre-written. It's all coming in here. So all the illnesses, there are three types of illnesses. Adi, biadi, and upadi. Adi illness is, so this, the three types, I'll just go straight simple. The three types are illness from within. So I'm going to go worst case scenario, like cancer, within illness. Illness externally given. Car accident, somebody hits you with a stick. Injury, cut on leg. External illness or external disease, external rogue. Internal, external, and then mansik, rogue of the mind. Tension, worry, pagalpana, depending on how extreme you want to go. Stress, yes? Three types, so they're written. In we come. So I'm in my life now. I've had my illness, that one's gone. Used it. My parents, I'm born, so my parents, that's not ever going to change again, gone. I've used up all the money that I was ever going to get given. I've eaten all the food God had planned for me, gone. By the end of the life, I'll have got rid of all of these. Yes? They're gone, they're not coming back. Then I'm ready to die. But while I've got rid of those, what have I been doing? Back to the top one. Kiryaman. I'm doing new ones. They come quicker than they go out. So if I've got 100 going out, there's probably about 1 million. Just simple numbers I've made up that are coming in. They come in quicker than they go out. I die. What's going to happen to these? They get collected back in the box. Sanchit Karam. That's where they were Kiryaman. Sanchit Karam. What happens to those? Next life, somebody comes in, pumps them out. Next body, off we go again. What's happening? So take Sikhi out of it for now. Take religion, everything out of it. What's happening? What's going to happen here? Life cycle. So we come and go through the life cycle. We go up and down that 8.4 million life. And it's happening over and over again. Now, some of you who are really listening carefully, What's happening to this? Increasing at a quicker rate than you are getting rid of them. This is the mail of Maya. Gurbani talks about mail lagiya. It doesn't mean dirt, that we're dirty people. It means these karma are described as mail in Gurbani. Mail lagiya. Those veils of Maya, the curtain that I talked about at the start, it's getting thicker. It's getting harder to remove because these, it's like papier mache just getting added on. You can't see through it. We're counted into this. It's done. So how are we going to get rid of this? What are we going to do? So what's... Any questions now? So there's a lot there that I've given you so far. Questions at this point?
Do you know what you're saying? That as we live our life, we're carrying on, we're creating more karma.
Yeah.
And when we die, we get put into the...
The sanchit karma. Sanchit.
So we go with the...
Rewards in this life.
This life, yeah.
Okay, that's a good question. That's one question I'm expecting you to ask. There's a few questions I'm expecting that you ask. Okay, if you don't ask them, I'll be disappointed because everybody else has asked them. So if, you know, unless you already know the answers. So that's one I expected. Do they go in there at the end or do they come with you? Some can happen straight away. For instance, I know, because I know he's stronger than me, if I punch Harai Singh over there, he's going to do his Gataka skills and beat me up. I'm going to reap that reward straight away. Yeah? Some things I'm going to get away with and I'm going to reap afterwards. Nobody can tell you which you're going to reap now and nobody can tell you which you're going to reap afterwards. So that's that question.
Sorry, I was just going to say, is that like, you know, when the children are born with, like, I don't know, maybe blindness or like with a missing...
You could say that everything is part of our karma. Now, we in the world, what do we think is good in the world? What's good? Honestly, take Sikhi out, take all the ideal answers out of it. What is good in this world?
Health,
wealth, honor, fame, fortune, everything. Comes into health and wealth. Matter, Maya, those things we describe as good. So we automatically think somebody who's blind, somebody who's disabled, we're going to think it's bad. So people are going to say, people will question you about this if you ask you about Tarasila Jun. So your religion says they're bad people, that's why they come like that. No. Because we believe, what we always forget, good and bad are just as bad as each other. Maharaj tells us to look at good and bad as the same. Good and bad are just as bad as each other. So we don't believe they're bad people. We don't believe anybody's a bad person. They're just in the system. And that's their system for them. This is ours for me. I can't mix into yours, you can't mix into mine. Mine are different to yours. We might cross paths. But yours are very much different to mine. They could be similar, but you've got your own path to live in.
Can you connect with God with a dumbbell?
Okay, so hold that question. We're going to answer that in a minute. The Sikhi question.
You know, Bhai Sahib was saying, does it affect our life now? Does the Manvachkaram philosophy kind of...
Mind, body, and speech?
Yeah, definitely.
That helping is getting out of it. That's what...
Is that what you're getting out of it?
Yeah, because we're doing them out.
Yeah, what you're doing, yes.
That's what we're doing, so that's what they are.
You know, when you get married, the Nankaram should say one wife, two bodies. So, if your wife does something bad, would that affect you in any way?
Well, from what you just said, it probably would, wouldn't it? Because either you will, not to blame the other person, let's blame ourselves. Let's say I'm the bad person, my wife's the good person. I could either drag my wife down, or she could drag me up. So, somebody's going to have a willpower to do. Hopefully, the person who's the good one is going to drag everybody up.
Thoughts, maybe.
Thoughts are part of this as well. They're not as strong as the actual action, but they're counted as well. Sankalp, they're called.
And he said the good and bad are the same. So then what's the point of us doing good action if it's just going to increase our karma?
What is a good action?
You said they're the same thing.
Yeah, but what is a good action? I'm defining good. What did we define good as in this world? But we didn't say that. We said health and wealth is good.
Achieving materials.
Okay, so I'll come now to the Sikhi point. Because what we get confused is, we get confused with the Sikhi good to the world good. And we mix the two together. I've only been talking, when I said Sikhi to the side, I'm talking about world good. Okay, let's go back to this, what I showed you earlier. What are people doing in Kaljug? What is Dataram left in Dataram? Dan karna, charity, is that good?
Yeah.
It's good, isn't it? Why are you doing that charity? Have you questioned yourself?
Makes
If you're doing it for lalach, you're doing rajagun stuff, aren't you? If you're doing it to get fame and show off to somebody. So is it really good what you're doing? It's good to the person who receives it. Is it good for you? That's the difference. So good and bad are the same. If you're not linked in with the reciting of the name of Naam Simran. So that's the cycle. We are here to, that was God's game. It was designed in an instant. We are here to come out of the system. We need a guru to tell us how to get out, because we can't find it out for ourselves, because we've got all these layers of maya. We've got all this mail. It said there, Kaljog is, just one second, Naam Simran is the way to find God. If you do Naam Simran, what you are doing, now the question I would have asked is, how do you get rid of these? How do you start decreasing these? Okay? Naam Simran. What is Naam? What's Naam? What is it? Very simply, very simple answer, what is it? So remembering, yeah? Remembrance of a word, repeating of a word. Let's go simpler. Let's take all of Sri Guru Granth Sahib, we just say one word, the word's Waheguru. Let's just keep it very simple. Repeating of a word, Waheguru. Say Waheguru. Gurbani says when you say it once, it burns hundreds and thousands of these. So you say it again. So you're burning hundreds and thousands of those as you're saying it. Okay? That's what it's going to do for you. But there's a proviso there. Where do we get that Naam from? Sorry? Gurbani?
Panch
Pyare. Could I just tell you what it is? Just say Waheguru, would it work for you? If I told you what it is, what do I become? The guru who gave it to you. So if I say do it, you'll be saved. You're going on my jummevari, my responsibility. But Guruji's been telling us last couple of days, Gur Pura Charni Laya, Pura Bure Guru Ne Charni Laya, Pura Guru, complete Guru. Previously, in these previous ages, we had deities, we had prophets, even in this age. They came for a reason to do and save us out of this system. When they came, because they were Satoguni, they still had Vishevikar. And so those deities, one person forsakes God, one person blames God, one person does a calm thing. These are all written in Gurbani and Sri Dasam Granth. So it's not me having a, this is all what Guruji is telling us. So one of these, I'm not going to name any of them, I'm not telling you which faiths they come from. One is fallen by calm, one falls by ego, one has fallen by anger, one has fallen by attachment, one has fallen by greed. Every single one of them came to the world with a duty. They could not do the job they were instructed to do because they fell due to the panch chor. God is sitting there watching, and the creation is crying for a savior. God keeps sending saviors who are not complete saviors. So God thinks or decides, maybe I need to go do the job myself. We know that saying, you can't get anybody else to do a job, do the job yourself. So God decides, let's just do the job ourselves. Aap Narayan Kalatar Jag Meh Parvaryo. God decides to come to this world themselves. Jot Roop Har Aap Guru Nanak Kahayo. They come in the form of Sri Guru Nanak Dev Sahib Ji. They prepare 9 other human looking bodies ready to pass on the light, because the system they designed, they don't come out of that system. They stay in the system as well when they're in this world. That's the amazing thing about God. They don't do anything special. They stay in the system. So when Guru Nanak Dev Sahib's physical age reaches a point, they leave, because they're not going to live for thousands of years, because they're not meant to. But in Kaljug, we only live up to 100 years, let's say, average. Okay, Guru Amar Das Sahib, you lived over 100. Some of the gurus, Sri Guru Hare Krishna Sahib Ji, didn't reach 10 years physical wise, did they? And some, you know, in different ages. So they live in that system. They teach the system. They're God themselves teaching the system. So other faiths, they gave Naam from Guru Nanak, Charnamrit. Charpai Gurdas Ji explains Charnamrit. Then Guru Gobind Singh Ji, Khande Bate Damrit. Then they give you Naam. Then when Guru Gobind Singh Ji goes on their knees and says, Minvi Amrit Shakado, Panj Pyare Go, we gave our heads. Tusi ki ditta. Sri Guru Gobind Singh Sahib Ji, Pehle Pita Kataya. I sacrificed my father. Fir Bete Kataunga. I'm going to sacrifice my children. They already tell everybody in 1699, I'm going to sacrifice Majar Sahibzade. Guru Nanak ka bagh, the flower, the garden, the flowers that Guru Nanak Dev Sahib Ji planted. Who's that? That's all of us. All of creation. Khoon, blood, jigar. If you want a simple English, sweat. So blood and sweat. Khoon, jigar, se phalaunga. I'm going to make the garden blossom with my blood and sweat. I'll sacrifice everything. Which they did. Char Sahib Ji de Varte, Pitaji Varta, Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahib Ji. Why? Because Khalsa meri jaan ki jaan. The Khalsa, that's all of us, whether we're Amritari or not, we're in the same family. It's the Khalsa family. Sikh means disciple. Khalsa is the family within it. We are their jaan. So they've sacrificed everything so we can be safe. They didn't want to come down. In Hemkund Sahib, they're saying, if you read Vichitra Natak, they're saying, I don't want to go down to the world. I'm happy in Sun Samadhi fixed with you. And Waheguru, they're explaining a discussion between God and them so we understand, because otherwise it becomes too abstract. That's why Guruji uses systems so we understand, because we're physical people in Maya. So some of those systems we think we take literally, but because if Guruji explained in abstract, we won't understand it. So Guru, Waheguru goes, you have to go down because the world needs you. So they come and they do what they need to do so we can be saved. Sorry, Pai Sahib.
I'm just going to ask, the way I understand it is when a Sikh takes Amrit and he starts living in red, after he leaves this world, this life, Guruji looks after him and, you know, he doesn't get judged. He's protected from that. But while within this life, is he still paying off his previous sins, or how does it work? Because obviously he's still...
Guru Gobind Singh Ji promised, Janam Maranda Ged Katya, that's what Pai Sahib's saying. So we're protected. So you see all these. If we follow, so that's the key word Pai Sahib said, if we follow what the Panch Pyari, the teaching Guru Gobind Singh Sahib Ji give us to the letter. Because Guru Gobind Singh Ji and the previous gurus gave us do's and don'ts. I'm not going to go into them. Well, I am, but I'm not going to delve into them. The do's, we know we do some nitrim, we keep Panch Kakar, yes? We have to give the swan, very simply, 10% of earnings, 10% of time. We do Naam Simran, we do Seva, we do Sangha, they're the do's. The don'ts, we don't cut our hair from the top of our heads to the bottom of our toes. We don't trim our beards. We don't pluck our eyebrows. We don't thread. We don't laser treatment. We don't colour. We don't burn our beards so they come to a nice shape. These are things that people do. We don't disrespect any case on our body. That's one don't. The second don't was, don't smoke tobacco or any other intoxicant, sharab, drugs, all of the rest of it. We don't eat meat prepared in a halal way. And then Sri Guru Granth Sahib Ji tells us further that we don't eat meat for Jeevdaswad, even if it's in a different prepared method. And then the fourth one is we don't commit adultery outside of marriage. So they give us do's and don'ts. If we stay in the do's and don'ts, then you know this goes like this. They promised us. They don't lie to us. Why would they sacrifice their family and then lie to us? Koi karda idda? Nobody does. You're right. They'll look after this. However, if we don't completely follow, then some of these kind of stay. They'll still look after us. Narkanjani Jandande, they say, promise all of those things. Because we're kind of staying in the way, but we're stumbling along. But we still, you know, Amritari, we're still doing our best. And then these ones are still happening, aren't they? Because I'm an Amritari, I'm still doing actions. I can still be bad to people. Do you think I'm going to get away with it? You know, I'm still going to get these. So good karam, worldly good karam, are these. Sikhi good karam, the do's and the don'ts. Actually, only good karam are the Sikhi do's and don'ts. No other karam can be described as a good karam apart from the Sikhi do's. Obviously, the don'ts, you don't do them anyway, but the do's, they're actually good karam. That good one, change karam karo. We don't mean the good ones, worldly sense. Say thank you to somebody, oh that's good anyway, that's helping your development, but that's not going to be the one, the good karma, the naam japna, vandhi shakna, kirt karniya, jhoot to bachke rehna, bajjar kreta to bachnaya, they're good karma, nishkam seva karniya. Oh, was it yourself, sorry.
Was it not right to say that from good karma that we've earned, that we're here now to be in Maharaj?
That's what I said, gur seva te bhagat kamai, tabe himanas dehi pai. That's why we're here. That's why you've got this opportunity.
How does the pre-written come into all of this then?
So this pre-written.
That's pre-written.
Yeah, paralabd. So that's the hukam. So we blame God sometimes. God's doing bad to us. We've had some questions on those sheets. They've got the right intention, but it's talking about bad people. Why does God bad, good? I can see the intention behind it because I have those same questions. But what I'm trying to say, we can't blame God for this, because who did these? Did God do these? We did them, didn't we? So really, they're our own karam. We did them. The only thing God's done is put them in here. Now you might think in this life, God has dealt us a bad card. But whatever's in there, we're going to be dealt with. They're our own cards. Sometimes we'll get good ones in some lives. Sometimes we get bad ones. Sometimes we get a mix. They're ours. We can't blame God for anything. That's what we call hukam. These are preordained. I've got a question that I would ask. I want to see what you guys are asking. Then I'm going to ask my own question. And then so two questions we'll take together.
So the Sanchit
that
are banned by the
exams and stuff like that. So these Sanchit ones, yeah? So the question is, what about these ones?
Can we erase them?
That's what that was my question. Thank you for asking it.
We believe in reincarnation.
Yeah.
We're trying to get to such kind to get
one with Wahiguru, yeah.
So where did heaven and hell come into?
And that links in with this as well. So I'll do the heaven and hell first and then I'll come to this question. So heaven and hell. So just think of heaven and hell like this. Okay, I'm gonna think on a world level. Again, it might be a silly example. You commit murder, where do you go? Prison. Okay? You spend 10 years, half of it. What happens? What happens then? Come out. Back in the world, aren't we? So a hell is a place that you could go to, depending, because Maharaj talks about hey kamang naraka bisramang bahojoni pramavane. They talk about different naraks. You go there, but it's temporary. After you spend time there for whatever you might have, or we might have done, we come back into the world. And gursikhs can end up in narak as well. Because they might not be coming and going, but we still have to pay for the bad things that I might have done. So they might send me there for a bit just to pay it off, and then I'll be saved. We can't get away with it because we haven't been completely right. So there's no getting away. Amartari is a starting point. After that, that's just the beginning of life. So that's the narak. And then the heaven is like, maybe you win a holiday, you go on a holiday, you do a few good things, you come back to the world, then your boring job again, Monday morning. You see what I mean? So you can think of it in that way. So they are there. Other religions talk about those at the end points. We don't. We're above all of that. Because we say they're temporary. Because you still have to come into the system. And you come and go. So what about these karam? Because I would want to know, if I've got a major illness, I don't really want it because I'm a kaljubi thief. You know, I don't want to go through bad, worldly bad things. I don't want any of these bad things. So how do I sort these out? So, this is what Guruji does. I'm going to tell you a couple of sakya, and it'll help you understand. So, in the time of Guru Arjan Dev Sahib, there was a king. There was a king, and I'll have to say them really quickly because time is really short. We've gone over already. It's 12 minutes past 1. Hannah? So I'm going to keep them really short and quick. The king, Guru Arjan Dev Ji, when they're doing the Sarovar Seva, they send Gursikh out to do, you know, so he makes money in a different town, helps, donates the money back, the Swandakadake. So he goes, Gursikh goes to a different town. In that town, they believed in statues. The king of the town, because in India, there were kings of villages. We see them as mayors, but they're kings all over the place. And Aurangzeb brought them all together. You know, the Mughal Raj brought them all together, but they were like the owners of the villages or whatever, the towns. So the king, his name was Hari Sen. It was a special day in Hinduism, and he made everybody come to the mandir, and he would say, everybody's going to pray to that murti. The Gursikh didn't go, because he is a Gursikh of Guru Arjan Dev Ji. He goes, we don't believe in patthar and this kind of stuff. He stayed in his shop or whatever he was doing. He got arrested. He was going to get tortured. He was going to get, you know, punished. Maybe he's going to be killed or whatever the punishment was, I can't remember. And he did ardas to Guru Arjan Dev Ji, just as he's about to be taken, to be hanged or whatever was going to happen to him. The king fainted. The king fainted, the sevadars of the king, they got scared. He didn't ask for the king to faint, it just happened after he did his marriage with Bujal. That's all he said, the king fainted. They realized something's happened here. So they go to the Gursikh, I forget the Gursikh's name. They go to the Gursikh, you did something, Kushkar, you didn't come, this is we're getting bad vibes. Because people who believe in karma khan, they believe in good luck, bad luck, they believe in all bad can happen as well, certain days and all this kind of business, get me worried by that. Bam, 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 bam. So you get worried that something's happened because of this. We've imprisoned you. Tu kushkar, you saved the king. Chal he does ardas. Maharaj, meton ko galti ya in bacha do. But he said, you lot put me in prison because of this murti puja. Sikha banoge fir? Sikhi, will you understand? Bhi murke tusi fir kana? He goes, no. Asi sikha banange, asi guru, we'll go meet Guru Arjan Dev Ji. We'll promise that much at least. King is out, king is worried, king goes, ha, minu, tera guru dikha, they go to Guru Arjan Dev Ji. They're at Amritsar doing the seva of the Sarovar. And then they've seen Guruji, they question Guruji. Because Guruji is reading Bani. Lekh na mitai hai sakhi jo likhya kartar. Lekh, whatever's written, na mitai. It doesn't mate ni hunda. It doesn't wipe away whatever God's written. So that's the question. Can we wipe these away? Gurbani says we can't. He read that pankti. He heard that pankti. And he says, that means it can't be written. You know, tu kada guru ma fir? I'm not going to make you my guru. Because what kind of guru are you? You're saying that you can't wipe these. If you're a complete guru, then you should be able to. Prophets and deities can help you with this a little bit, because they send you to that paradise and all the rest of it. But a true guru, if you wanted a guru, you not only want him to sort these out, you want him to sort this out as well, don't you? That's what we'd want. Otherwise, it's 50% of the deal. We want everything. So he goes, you're a kacha guru, tu pura nahi ho sakda. Said to Guru Arjan Dev Ji, because you can't, your bani saying it's pre-written. It doesn't change. And Guru Arjan Dev Ji goes, yeah, bani doesn't lie, everything's true in it. And he says, I want an answer to that. Fear me. And Guru Arjan says, don't worry, chal, you'll find an answer. Stay 3 days in Amritsar from your town. Patti was the pind he was from, and he came to Amritsar. He stayed for 3 days. Now, because he was a king, he liked hunting. Guru Arjan Dev Ji in the morning sent him a letter from one of the Guru Sikhs. Guru Arjan Dev Ji saying to you, go hunting. Don't get bored here. You're a king, you like to do king things. There's a jungle in this direction. Go hunting. So he decides to go hunting. But that night, he went to sleep. He went to sleep and he had a dream. And his dream was him, the king, dying, being born in a family. A Chandalandi family is described as a really greed, parvar. He's gets married, he grows old, he gets married, has kids, he's really grieved. And then one day he dies, they bury him, he sees everything. From start of life to the end of life, buried. And then he wakes about the dream and he's really worried, sweating, thinking, I'm a king, I was born in that, that's really, because, oh, they call hankar si, main gareeb parwar, main lokaan di, you know, lid chakdaya and all this, I'm doing all this dirty work, that's not for me, I'm a king, that was such a bad dream. Anyways, he's had that dream, he gets the message, he goes hunting. Off he goes hunting. When he goes hunting, he gets off his horse, he looks for water. So he has a few of his people with him, from his court. He looks for a stream. Then two or three kids come and they see him. And they look at him. And they say, he looks like our dad. And they start screaming at him. You're our dad. He looks at them. And he goes, I'm not your dad. I'm the king of Patti. My name's Hari Sen. What you want about? Mata Raja hai, mere sahib jadde ya, mere sahib jadiyan ne. And they go running back home to their mother. Sada pita ji utthe baitha. She comes. The whole family start telling you, like you might see, you know, like the whole pind sara katha ho ke, you know, you're our father. We only buried you last week. What are you doing? You scantus. Was that the wrong person? You need to come home. Look at you wearing good clothes. You got horses. You forsaken us. Asi griba de tum kithe chale gaya, and all this kind of business. Guru Arjan Dev Ji follow with Gur Sikhs. They get to that point. Hari Sen's worried because Hari Sen, in his dream, they were the same people. Those kids were his kids in his dream that he had the night before. That woman was his wife in his dream. So he didn't say anything, but he's worried because he recognizes everybody. And Guru Arjan Dev Ji, they knew Guru Arjan Dev Ji, be Guru Amritsar daya, it's in the Nalda pind de vich Amritsar shehar a, used to be known Ramdaspur, be tusi dasso this is our husband, nirna karo, you know, like a learned person, become the mediator. Guru Arjan Dev Ji goes, well, you said your father died. Just go have a look at the grave, open it up, have a look. They go open it up, they say, sorry, huh? Sada Pita Jute is buried. They come back to Guruji Amritsar. The king goes, Guruji, you know, I need to tell you something. I had a dream last night. Those people were the same ones. And Guruji goes, remember that question you asked? Be Guru di inni kalaya. If you're meant to go through something and you don't want to go through it, Gurbani bhi sachi hai, you'll go through it. But Waheguru supneyan chh naga danda ya. So sometimes we have dreams. They seem really real. It could be that there's things that were going to happen if it was about, you know, and Guruji's put it out. But sometimes you think the worldly good stuff, that's gone as well. They do stuff to us in dreams. So we naga danda sama. So they're written, they're meant to happen, but they happen, not physically, but they just happen. And then final sakhi I want to share very quickly. It's Guru Gobind Singh Ji's time. Same thing happened. A Muslim peer came to Guru Gobind Singh Ji. His name was Salahuddin. And he questioned Guruji. He's questioned Guruji because obviously he's a Muslim. He's from a different religion. And he's questions Guruji. He goes, you say everything is God's hukam. That's what everybody says. God's hukam. That's what God ਇਸ ਇੱਥੇ ਲੋਕ ਆਉਂਦੇ ਆ ਅਰਦਾਸਾਂ ਕਰਨ ਅਰਦਾਸ ਕਰਦੇ ਆ ਐਂਡ ਦੈਨ ਤੂੰ ਕਹਿ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਯੋ ਵੈਲ ਯੂ ਸੋਲ ਯੋਰ ਥਾਪਰਾ ਵਟਐਵਰ ਦੇ ਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਯੂਸ ਟੂ ਡੂ ਇਟਸ ਡਨ ਸੋਰਟਿਡ ਫੋਰ ਯੂ ਆਰ ਸੋਰਟਿਡ ਇਟ ਐਂਡ ਦ ਸਲਾਰ ਦੀ ਕੁਐਸਚਨ ਸਿੱਖੀ ਗੋਜ਼ ਆਈਦਰ ਯੋਰ ਅ ਲਾਇਰ ਯੂਰ ਅ ਫਾਲਸ ਗੁਰੂ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਇਫ ਗੁਰੂਜ਼ ਹੁਕਮ ਇਜ਼ ਟਰੂ ਐਂਡ ਦੇ ਕਮਿੰਗ ਟੂ ਡੂ ਅਨ ਅਰਦਾਸ ਟੂ ਯੂ And you're giving them everything, then you're a liar. You're blagging all them. You're just making followers. Jidha hun pakhandi guru karde ya. Yeah? Or, God's wrong and you're right. Either God's right, you're wrong, you're right, God's wrong. Yeah? And Guruji called for their stamp. They called for their stamp. And the stamps in those forms were rings. So, you know, when they wrote Gurbani, they would sign it with a stamp. Some Sri Guru Granth Sahib Ji Sarups have got their stamp. It's got their name on it. You know the Aarti Aarta we sang last night? Some of the words are in the Aarti Aarta we sang after Rehra Sahib. I'm not going to read them all out. But when they say their name, Guru Gobind Singh, you know, some of those pangti are what's on the stamp. And he pulled the stamp out and he said, read the stamp. Guru Gobind Singh said that Salah had been. Now, if I show you a stamp, would you be able to read it?
No.
Why won't you read it?
Because
backwards, isn't it? So then Guruji, he goes, I can't read it exactly what you say. Then they brought the ink out, stamped the ink, pulled the piece of paper, stamped it. Then they go, now read it. Then he read it. It said Guru Gobind Singh Ji's name and, you know, whatever they'd signed on, whatever they had on their stamp. And they said, what's written on the stamp and what's written on the paper, is that different? And he goes, no, it's the same because it wouldn't be able to translate into this. If it was different on the stamp, it would say something else. When you stamped it. So it's the same thing. And say, so what's the difference? He goes, Utthe putha si, itthe siddha ya. Guru Gobind Singh Ji, this is the difference. This is what Guru, Sadguru ki karda. Je itthe putha likhya, Guru ne aake siddha kar dena. So, these can change. They can change. Jithe putha ya, Guru Ji siddha kar dena. So the complete, pura Guru can do this for us. O bhi khatam kar duga. And I did say it was the final Sakhi, but another one's come to my mind because the next question you might have. So that was Siddha Putta. And this is me, my own research, because I had all these questions myself. So the next question I would have in my mind is, if it's not in here, and it's not in here, and I want something from my father, like when you're younger and you want a computer game or something, we don't have it, my brother, the cousin doesn't have it, can he give me something that I don't have? And Guruji can even do that for you. Because there was a Gursikh called Baba Adamji. They were about 60, 70 years old. 60, 70 years old. They didn't have no kids. They did seva. Again, Guru Arjan Dev Sahib Samar. They did seva in the Sarovar. All these Gursikhs did seva. So look at the common thing that's going through here. When you want these to change. Naam Simran and seva and Sangat. But you need the Tarnamrat in those days and Khandebat Damrat now. That's the common thing that you need to affix to. Why this is all happening. So they wanted a child, they go to Guru Ramadas Sahib Ji, the original time when the seva is happening, so this Guru Ramadas Sahib Ji, they did seva, Guruji goes, Mango ki mangdeo, asked all the Gursikhs, what do you want? He got embarrassed because everybody's looking, sochda si bhi, sare mein kehna buddha bachcha mangda. He's about 60, 70 years old, and so he didn't ask for anything. Guruji knew what he wanted and said, chal, go home, discuss it with your wife, come back, mainu kal nu puchni. Comes back with his wife the next day, and they ask, they pluck up the courage, they ask, Guruji looks, in here, and says, you don't have a kid written in here. Then they go and look in here to see if you got it in, because they don't want to change the system, do they? That's what the important thing. Guruji doesn't change the system they create. They live within it, we live within it. But they find a way for us. So they look in this one, and this, because they thought, if you're going to get a kid maybe three lives down the line, I'll just bring it from there and put it in here. They looked in there and they said, you haven't even got a kid in there. You two have never got any kids ever. So what can you do? They go, thode likhe nahi. Baba Adamji goes, tu sidha guru, you can do anything. So Guruji had three sahibzade, Guru Ramadas Sahib Ji. Their elder one called Prithi Chand, second one called Mahadev Ji, third one was Sri Guru Arjan Dev Sahib Ji themselves, our fifth guru. And Guruji goes, I have a child in my pagati, in my system. Now, you might think, how does guru have a system? They don't. But they're using it to explain the system. Otherwise, people get confused because they always brought themselves down to a humble level, to our level. Every guru did that. As Guru Gobind Singh just did, bowing down. They bring everything down to the basic level. So we don't question. And they go, Mere bhagati jo tusi kar bachcha rakh lo. the bacha, they had a son, his name was Pagtu. There's a pind village in the south of Punjab named after Pai Pagtu. It's called Pai Pagtu, or Pagtu Pai, it's actually called. It's a famous Gursikhi family. And that lineage came from Guru Ramadas Sahib Ji, and they had a child, Baba Jeevan Ji, a true son. And they, a lot of history with those Gursikhs.
I was just going to say another example is the BBG who used to do seva, I think it was Sheva Bhasha, and she would go and ask for a child. And he would always say,
that's
to her,
right, that's right.
You can't, it's not in your destiny. And then one day when she went again, she went 2-3 times, and she was obviously sad, went away, and a good sikh, I think, said to her, with Lukmachani.
Pai Gurdas Ji said.
And so then he told her what to go and say, I believe. And
that's
then
right.
She went back and she said, I want a child. And Guruji again said, we did a kiswajilik. And then she said,
that's exactly right.
And then, so he got happy and he was about to write it, and then he's about to write one, and he wrote, the horse moved, and he wrote 7 by mistake, and then he said, I'll get that, that's it. And then she has 7 children after that.
So, my question was, you know when you say that Guruji plucked a son out of his thing, what do you really mean by that? That like he can create anything he wants at any time?
Yeah, because Bhais have just clarified that, hasn't he? Because who's the writer of this? We say God writes this, doesn't he? So if God's the writer, Guru's God, they can write anything. So they can pluck it from anywhere. They can write anything for you if you want. But who do they write it for? What did I say? Khalsa meri jaan ki jaan. Khalsa bano. They'll write anything you want. Anything. Guruji, you know when we talk about log par log. Have you heard that phrase? You might hear in a gurdwara, you hear in programs. Log vi sukhiye par log vi sohile. Par log is this. Afterlife, what we're going to get afterwards. Log is this. They help us in this and they help us in this. They help us in both. Not only will they give you spiritual development, because to all these gursikhs, they give them sikhi deti, naam deta, par hor vi mangala je mangana. If you want some ash while you're living in the world, what do you want? Do you want kids? Do you want fit? They'll give us that as well. You know those things I was saying, good in the world? They'll give you those as well. So if we feel like we want those, when we listen to aarti, Bhagat Ji goes, Dal Siddha Mago Kiyo Hamara Khushi Karanit Jiyo Paniya Shadan Nika Anaj Mago Sat Sika. Basically, there's a Shabad of the Bhagat, and I think it's Sanji, if I'm correct, maybe I'm wrong, there's a Bhagat is saying, I'm not doing your Bhagati, I can't, main pukhaya. I need food, I need a family, I need this, I need that. That's when we sing Aarti in the evening, he's asking, say, if you want me to do Sikhi, I want these things as well. What I'm trying to say is, when you get into a relationship with your guru, such like your own parents, our parents, when we grow older, we become friends of our parents as well, don't we? We have that kind of relationship. We can have that relationship with our parents as well. That's what we like with our guru. We have that relationship where we can, jo marji mangi jao na to, baapa sada douga, kato ni douga. Like you for your kids, those of you that have them, and your parents for you, they would have tried everything to sort everything out. Itna hi guru ne karna hai. But bacche bano. That's the key. That's why I don't want to scare anyone, I don't want to offend anybody. Bacche kitna banana? Those do's and don'ts. That's important. Don't hide that away. That's the way we're going to be saved. That is very important.
Well, this brilliant system that you said Maharaj is buying, why don't you just leave us on the carousel? And he's done his bit, he's made this brilliant system. We're all on the carousel, why don't you just leave us on there and be good with it?
Well, if we're on the carousel, we talked about that before, we talked about the Sikhi side. We'll never get out of here.
But why get out of here? Why just carry on with the Charasila Kajun? Go round and round.
Do you want to carry on in the Charasila Kajun?
No, not really.
That's
why. Why has he given us that thought? Why has he given us that thought? To say, you know what, this ain't really right. You know, we could have just carried on.
Yeah, because he is obviously compassionate to us. Because we've done some positive things. We have had to go through certain things in our lives that we think are bad. Look, I'm sat in front of you like this. You're sat in front of you. You know, everybody has bad times. Nobody's had good everything, 100% good times. Everybody has them. You have to find the place for yourself. Oh, bad times are not God's fault. They're our fault anyway, because he is the carousel. But what does God do? Because asi kuch unne di bhakti kiti hai pehla. Asi kuch seva kiti hai in a previous life. Asi kuch changa kita hai. We should be not think about we should think how lucky are we. Karta tars sadete. They gave us an opportunity, because if we don't know about the Guru, we won't understand this. Because not everybody knows about this system. People don't believe in reincarnation, Charasi Lakh Joon. What's happening to them? They've got the Maya de Parde lagge hoya. Or their prophet couldn't see that far. Just like There was a time, Patala Pata, Lak Agasa Agas, Sri Guru Nanak Dev Sahib Ji's gone to Mecca, outside, no, sorry, Baghdad, they're outside of Baghdad. They're singing Japji Sahib in the morning, Utte Peer, Dastagir Peer Da Chelaya. He's saying, this, they're doing Kirtan, Pai Mardana, but it's forbidden in Islam to do Kirtan. They can't pray with music. Guruji goes, Patala Pata, Lak Agasa Agas, there's hundreds and thousands of worlds. But Muhammad Sharif has only said this, I think, seven. Yeah, so he goes to his Dastigir Peer and he goes, this blasphemy going on. This koi ayat hai Nanak. He's playing a musical, his Pai Mardana is playing a musical instrument. That's against Islam, Sharia laws in this country. Now he said something against Muhammad's teachings. Dastigir Peer goes, fatwa lao, stone him to death. They come running out to stone Guru Nanak Dev Ji and Pai Mardana Ji. Pai Mardana Ji looks up and he's getting scared. He looks at Guru Nanak Dev Ji. Guru Nanak Dev Ji goes, just keep playing, lad. Don't worry about it. And he's getting worried. And they throw, Rabat to throw the stone. Sri Guru Nanak Dev Sahib Ji goes, Sat Sri Akal, Gurbar Akal. And they just froze at that point. The stone's dropped. Dastagir Peer gets worried. He comes himself and he tries. And he Ovi jud gaya, frozen. Phir andro maafi mangi. Guru Nanak Dev Sahib Ji opened them up. Phir baithe vichara kitiya, he showed his son Lakh Patal, Lakh Agas. He says, Je Thoda Peer, Thoda Pakambar, if Muhammad was on the right path, but he didn't see everything. Je, if he didn't see everything, that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Yeah? I've never been anywhere else in Wales apart from here. That doesn't mean Wales doesn't exist, does it? That's it, jinne ko bande nu disda unni ko di gal karda. That's the other thing. So that point is important. So if we go for any other guru, he's not going to be complete. Jithe tak o guru di nigaya, jithe tak o di shakti, where that power is, that's all they'll be able to get you to. So why settle for second best? Go for the greatest, then you can get everything.
So in the same way, I heard in some kata about Buddha, he experienced God, but he couldn't explain it to his followers. So they took it as there is no God.
That's what they say, but some people say Buddha didn't even experience God, so he might not have reached. I don't know, I haven't researched, I don't want to comment on anything that I don't know.
You hear a lot of people talk about past lives, they remember what they were in the past life.
So if you do bhakti, there's a few slides here. I'm going to carry on after langar. We're going to stop now. We're going to go to langar. I hope those kind of questions I might talk about after langar. So when you do spirituality, you can start understanding your past and future lives. Because you know our eyes, these are physical eyes. They only see here. When you open your spiritual eyes, you see different points in time and you see your karma. So if you want to know what they are, you can't see them. If you want to see them get burnt, you can see them get burnt.